Good afternoon. Hi, my name is Dean Kim. I'm the surgical director of the kidney and pancreas transplant program here. Usually this spot here is occupied by Dr. Abeljude, but he's away today. And then it might have been Dr. Brown, but she's away today. And then it might have been Dr. Yoshida, but since there's no one else available, they thought they would ask me to introduce Dr. Alangaden. But that's no insult on Dr. Alangaden. I think all of us know who Dr. Alangaden is. But I did write some stuff up about him, and I did want to introduce him to you. So as most of you know, Dr. Alangaden is our chief of transplant and infectious diseases here at Henry Ford. He currently is a professor of medicine at the Wayne State University School of Medicine. And like I said, he's the program director for the transplant infectious disease program. Interestingly, or maybe because of the fact that we had other transplant infectious disease faculty, Dr. Alangaden has served as mentor to many of the transplant infectious disease faculty, either here or at Wayne State, including Dr. Ramesh and Dr. Lomfranco, as most of you folks know. He received his medical degree at the University of Bombay and received his internal medicine training both in India and the United Kingdom. He then was foolish enough to come to the United States to repeat his internal medicine training, and where he did receive his internal medicine training at the Wayne State University, Harper University Hospitals. And then he went on to do further training at Wayne State in his infectious disease fellowship, which he completed in 1994. He rapidly rose to the ranks to professor of medicine, which he achieved in 2008. And then we were fortunate enough to recruit him to Henry Ford from Wayne State in 2012. So, if you look at his CV, it's pretty extensive. You know, I can't really go through it all. I mean, he's got a lot more than I do. But he's been very active in the research realm. He's had he's had 30 grants. He's had over 100 peer-reviewed journal articles, 11 book chapters, and over 100 abstracts. So today he's going to talk to us about donor-derived infections in solid organ transplantation, minimizing risk and improving outcomes. So please help me welcome Dr. Alangaden to this podium.
Thank you, Dean. Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for that kind introduction, Dean. I think I met you all in some capacity or the other. And I'm really happy to be doing this presentation in the 50th anniversary of the Henry Ford Transplant Institute. And more importantly, if you all are interested in scientific subjects like this, I would really strongly encourage all of you all to attend the symposium that will be on November the 2nd, together to celebrate the 50th anniversary. And there'll be speakers who'll be talking about all aspects, including infectious diseases. But with that said, over the next few minutes, what I want to take is a moment to review with you donor-derived infections and how can we minimize risk and optimize outcomes. So I have no disclosures to make related to this. The objectives are to review the incidence, the epidemiology, risk factors, our current preventative strategies and management when transmission does occur. I'd like to focus on three aspects which I thought might be useful. Many of you all are familiar with what we termed as increased risk donor criteria. There's some recent guidance from last year that talks more about this, fleshes it out in more detail, so that we are not wasting increased risk organs and we're utilizing more of those for our patients. Second, there's some data on how often does potential donor-derived transmission events occur, and I'll share that with you. And then finally, we'll touch a little bit on selected pathogens that are commonly seen or pathogens that are currently emerging. So all of us know there's an increasing need for organs, and we also hope over time the expansion continues of the donor pool. Now the donor pool in the United States is very multi-ethnic, it's very diverse, and the risk for acquisition of infections is dictated mostly by the donor lifestyles, travel, resident in specific areas and such. And there is a potential risk that these pathogens, many of which may be active or latent in the donor, could end up being transmitted in the course of an organ transplant. So I'll share three illustrative cases. Some of y'all may recognize these patients. This first patient was a liver transplant recipient. The donor was someone who was an active intravenous drug user who was admitted with a stroke and died from the stroke and had mitral valve endocarditis. We had this information available. Now the donor had cleared all the blood cultures, for 4 days prior to organ procurement. We had him actually on treatment for VRE with daptomycin at that time. And for good measure, we gave him some vancomycin too. Yet he developed MRSA bacteremia almost immediately after. And you can imagine, the liver is such a vascular organ, it probably came with a huge burden of MRSA in it. We treated that patient for 4 weeks, but he then went on to have two more relapses, including septic emboli in the lungs and splenic infarcts. So this is notable also for one reason, because the CDC, and Ramesh is a co-author on that publication, took samples from the liver transplant recipient as well as a lung transplant recipient who also developed MRSA bacteremia. And this is the first time they did whole genome sequencing to match up the donor isolate with what. And the donor isolate was recovered actually from the brain tissue. So, and then Marissa, one of our first transplant ID fellows, went on to publish what are the lessons that we learned from this case. And this just shows you the three episodes of the same isolate in this patient. So that was a case where a very virulent pathogen can still break through despite all the interventions that we put in place. This is a case where the donor, we got this information after the liver transplant had occurred, that the splenic tissue showed organisms consistent with histoplasma. Based on that, we started this patient on itraconazole. The lungs went to a neighboring institution and they also started itraconazole. Our patient stopped it because of GI intolerance, didn't tell anyone, and then ended up with a pneumonia diagnosed with histoplasma 4 months after the transplant. Now the other patient stayed on itraconazole, so I used that as the negative control to say it works. But this just illustrates that infections can happen late, not immediately too, after a transplant. And this last patient, this was a donor, was a patient who was in good health, came in with community-acquired pneumonia, all microbiology testing negative, did not respond to broad-spectrum antimicrobial therapy and died without a diagnosis. Only the kidneys were transplanted, we received the kidney. Our donor did very well. 6 weeks later, he develops fever, a dry cough, and progressive graft failure. In fact, the graft was explanted. And at this time, the virus panel done because he had a dry cough was positive for adeno. And subsequently, the blood test showed the patient had adenovirus viremia. Ramesh was on this case, and he said, let's call the OPTN and have the stored blood sample tested, and that was positive for adenovirus, suggesting that this was probably a donor-derived transmission that occurred about 6 weeks. Now you may say 6 weeks, but this is the time when most of the immune suppression kicks in after day 30, when you get T-cell immune dysfunction where viral infections may reactivate at that time. So these three illustrative cases shows, and many of y'all are familiar with this timeline of routine management. When do we anticipate infections? How do we prophylax? But what I want to add to this is the fact that we also have to be mindful that donor-derived infections can occur early and much earlier than the anticipated timelines might suggest. So some of the characteristics these cases illustrate is, one, these are unanticipated, some of them, like the adenovirus. These are unexpected based on routine serology testing and history testing that we do in donors and recipients. It often may occur as clusters. We may not know about these clusters till you inform your program's patient safety officer, which is Linda Monroe here. And then you request more donor history, and you ask the OPTN to tell you what happened to the recipients who got the other organs from this particular donor. Are they doing well? And you can also do additional testing if necessary to identify some of this. But I cannot emphasize enough that finally the key element that results in detection of DDIs is your clinical suspicion. So, you know, a good history plus something doesn't feel right is often the first time you would identify these. So I would just say, you know, it's the clinical sort of vigilance that often detects many of these unexpected transmissions. I've listed here some of the potential transmissible infections. I've listed some syndromes. Encephalitis is highlighted here because encephalitis of an unknown etiology is a contraindication to accepting the donor. And the reason is because transmission of things such as rabies and things which may go undetected at this time but can be invariably fatal and for which we have no therapy. So that is one relative contraindication, just keep that in mind. Frequently we are called about patients who have bloodstream infections, but as long as the bloodstream infection is cleared, it's something that we have antibiotics to treat with, those patients should be okay. But that Mercer case still haunts me. You know, we accepted that based on clearance, but still ended up with infection. We get calls about both pneumococcal and meningococcal meningitis. These patients, as long as they clear the infection, should be safe for organ procurement. Candidemia and Rayleigh aspergillus are may be transmitted. If you live in the endemic area, like in the Coxie Belt, you may see cases of coccidioidomycosis, both transmitted from donor as well as reactivation in the host. And though histo is rarely transmitted, it did happen, as in the case that I did illustrate. The three viruses that every donor is screened for is HIV, hepatitis B, and hep C, as shown there. But there are transmission recorded from all of those, and a recent report of even transmission of dengue from donor to this. That was a report from Colombia. Parasitic infections, toxo is not unexpected. We screen all of heart and maybe lung transplants for it, but sometimes strongyloides can be transmitted, causing hyperinfection and disseminated disease, as well as in the right context in South America, you should, donors and recipients are screened also for trypanosoma. Now, I talked a bit about infections. These are some of the other things. If someone has CJD, you really don't want to transplant that organ from that donor. Malignancies, particularly melanoma, has a predilection for, you know, causing transfer into. So these are some of the other disease states that might be transmitted. So what can we do? Every transplant program has been directed by the OPTN to have a few things in place. OPTN, for its role, will inform you of potentially transmitted infection in the donor. Then it's up to you to assess, you know, is the benefit of transplant worth the risk? And then if you know of a donor transmissible infection that's present, then special informed consent should be obtained. And we'll talk a bit about that in a moment. And then you need to have a plan in place. How do I treat the recipient for this infection to prevent it, or monitor the patient for development of disease in case there's nothing to treat at the time of transplant. So I'll focus now a little bit on what we term as increased risk donors. And this risk applies just to HIV, hepatitis C, and hep B. Just a plug here for hep B vaccine. I would remove hep B if we sort of vaccinated all of our recipients of potential candidates, because you would significantly reduce the risk of HBV transmission. But nonetheless, in 2013, the United States Public Health Services established these guidelines. And these guidelines state that increased risk replaces what we previously used to call high risk, means high risk primarily for HIV. But this now includes hep B and hep C. It refers primarily to donor characteristics that could place a recipient at risk for transmission despite your best screening strategies. And this includes serology as well as nucleic acid testing. So this is really trying to identify just recently infected patients. Say, for instance, someone who dies from an opioid overdose, injection drug user, that would be that group, and the dog, it could all be negative in that little window. So it's just primarily for recent donors. So these are the criteria. Basically, these are the risk factors for HIV, Hep C, and Hep B. I won't walk you through all this except to say that intravenous drug users are the highest risk category in this group, followed by commercial sex workers, and so on. Now, why is dialysis patients there for Hep C? It's been shown that if you take the cumulative risk for someone on hemodialysis, they have a similar risk of transmission or acquisition of Hep C as someone who might be, you know, a commercial sex worker. It's more or less the same risk. So this is something you could talk to your patients about. The longer you stay on dialysis, you will, you know, you're at risk for Hep C, and the risk might actually be lower by accepting an increased risk donor criteria organ rather than putting it off for later. Pediatric, I will not touch on. A note about hemodiluted samples. So hemodilution means if you give more than 2 liters of blood or crystalloids, you know, for 48 hours before you sample the blood, or at least 1 liter of some crystalloid products given 1 hour before sampling, that's considered hemodilution, where serology could be falsely negative. So that is considered automatically as a high-risk donor. And the OPTN will tell you about that information. And if really you have no donor history, you should consider, they say, the highest risk possible. So what has happened since 2013? We have seen that disease donors that met increased risk criteria has continued to increase. And some of this increase may be a reflection of the change in criteria, which is broader now. But it also may be, you know, it's coinciding a lot with the opioid overdoses that's happening. And that might also be a reflection of this. But what has happened as far as donor acceptance has increased? So we know that, you know, there's been an increase in the number of increased risk donor organs that were procured. But up to 16.4% of transplant programs refused all increased risk. So that's a pool of organs that potentially goes waste. But about 42% use at least 10% of all their recipients use that. And we probably fall into this category because, as Linda shared this information today with me, since 2014, we have done 315 donors that had increased risk criteria, and I'm not aware of any potential transmission of HIV, Hep C, or Hep B in that group. So that's really encouraging. So the guidance document came out to address some of the reluctance that both transplant centers and patients may have regarding accepting these organs. So that's the reason I wanted to share some of this, and I realize some of you all are not transplant physicians, but previously, before seroconversion, there is a window where patients may be viremic, but the serology is still negative. So by introducing nucleic acid test or NAT, we were able to significantly shorten this window to detect viremia. But there's still a small period called the eclipse period where both of these tests would miss a potential infection. So when you look at nucleic acid testing, there are a few points that we can make. Compared to serological testing, it has shortened the window by almost tenfold. In fact, if you compare the two, you'll see that by doing nucleic acid testing for HIV and Hep C, the window is as small as 5 days. You know? For hepatitis B, for whatever reasons, it still could be as long as 21 days. But what this tells you is that if you have a living donor who doesn't exhibit any high-risk behavior, 3 weeks before the organ donation, that's probably, there's no risk of transmission of any of these because they would have been picked up by one of these tests. This is a busy slide, but I'll break it down in the next few slides. On the left side are risk categories that include male sex with male, injection drug users, commercial sex workers, hemophilia, partners of the previous categories, blood exposure, and incarceration for more than 3 continuous days. These are all considered risk factors, but right away we know a few things. One, the risk is not the same. If you look at the risk in injection drug user of 4.9% by NAT for HIV and 32% for Hep C, this is considerably higher than the risk in a hemophiliac patient. So when you talk to patients, it's very important to kind of convey, you know, which risk category are you dealing with, where you kind of ascertain risk. Second, what you also realize is the risk for hepatitis C transmission is far greater than HIV. So that's another thing that you could possibly keep in mind. So just to be mindful, they're not all uniform. There are different risks within this increased risk category. But nevertheless, what I've highlighted in red are the three highest risks. All of them relate to hepatitis C. In injection drug users, commercial sex worker, or partners, about those one or two. So you should always base your risk identification on the NAT testing. You know, that shortens the window. So that's basically one thing. And second, even in the highest risk category, that risk of transmission is less than 1%. It's actually 0.2%, as you'll see in some data at the most. So this is reassuring to realize that, you know, the risk, even from this increased risk donors, is less than 1%. And our own data of 315 with no transmission events, you know, kind of speaks to that. So how do we do this? We do screening initially. The screening uses an interview tool that's accessible online, which is quite comprehensive. Now, obviously, for deceased donors, it's much harder to do because the person giving the history may not know all of the lifestyle and at-risk behaviors of it. But in a living donor, you have enough time to collect all of this information. Then, generally, serology is the preferred test, always for HIV and Hep C. For Hep B, there is some this thing, but some centers do both serology as well as NAT testing, and I'll talk to that in just a moment. Now, the recipient should clearly understand that increased risk is the risk of disease transmission. It does not mean that the organ is compromised in any way, or the risk of graft failure is high. That's not the implication. The implication relates just to transmission risk. So that should be made clear. And also, if you see the management of HIV, even though we cannot cure it, there is very effective management if transmission should occur. Hep C, we can cure it with the current therapy, so that's potentially something, and we are doing Hep C organ donations now. And thirdly, hepatitis B, though we cannot cure, we can certainly suppress, but I would still put in a plug for vaccinating all candidates, because this way that doesn't become an issue, you know, post-transplantation. And then finally, we inform that we will monitor them and do testing. And the testing is done in this particular fashion. Pre-transplant, you do the testing, you know, of the recipient as well as the donor. The deceased donor is done at the time of transplant, living donors at least within a 28 window period. At 1 to 3 months, you should repeat the test using NAT for all of these three viruses. And then at 12 months post-transplant, you should repeat serology for hepatitis B. You don't have to do the testing for HIV and Hep C at this time. So when the OPTN Advisory Committee for Disease Transmission looked at all events from 2008 to 2016, they noticed that there were 15 cases of donor-derived HCV transmission that occurred despite serology and NAT testing. In 4 of these 15, it was due to some lab error in testing or personal error that resulted in false negative results. Second, 11 of those occurred within the serological window or the NAT window. 4 were when NAT was not being done, just serology was the framework. But what you see there is 7 occurred even with negative serology and NAT. And they believe in many of these, it could have been, you know, intravenous drug use or something that could have infected the person just at the time they're still in the eclipse period. There's been no HIV transmission since 2013 in any organs donated in the United States. I'm going to shift gears a little bit to share with you some information, what is known about this potential donor-derived disease transmission events. So in 2005, the OPTN had a committee formed, which is called as the Disease Transmission Advisory Committee, that periodically puts out reports. And they review all reports from the OPTN that we report to them, or they identify. And these are then reviewed initially by one or two people before the full committee gets a report. And what they look at is, did the event really occur? Is it proven or probable? They also classify it as possible. They exclude, and most than half of them are excluded right off the bat. But they also have a category which is very important, because that is our contribution to this, is interventions that resulted in preventing transmission. And we do this all the time when we get positive culture reports and other things available. So based on that, and this you don't have to struggle to read it, but I'll just summarize it here, that disease transmission occurred in 0.2%. And this slide includes both infections as well as malignancies. And this obviously was slightly more in disease donors, because a lot of the history and testing is not available compared to living. Only 0.13% of recipients went on to develop disease, and 0.03% actually died from a transmitted disease illness. So the risk is really very small, based on the 2013 data. And since we have kind of been watching this, I haven't seen any other reports that have come up of unusual clusters of transmission and so on. So when we look at this information, we know that they looked at 284 reports, of which 203 were related to infection. The rest was malignancy or something non-infectious, of which 12% were proven, 45% were excluded, and more importantly, 33% transmission was prevented because the centers did some form of intervention to prevent transmission. So that is a group that we should all be vigilant about and kind of address. Among the pathogens, bacteria and viruses were predominantly the pathogens that resulted in some form of reporting and transmission. Lungs and livers were the two most organs that had the greatest number of reports generated as well as transmission events. So talking about bacteria, 11% of all were, you know, or 11 out of 99 had either proven or probable, of which 12 recipients were affected and one death. That one death was due to MRSA, bacteremia, and infection. So staph was the by far, you know, one of the most common transmitted pathogens. So I would say Staph aureus, Pseudomonas, some of those new multi-drug resistant pathogens, it's something we should be watchful for. Mycobacterium, there was a lot of reports, but there was really never any proven transmission. So it's relatively low risk. If you look at virus-related events, there were 62, of which 8 or 13% were proven or probable, resulted in transmission to 13 recipients and one death. Of note, hepatitis B and CMV, two things that we routinely screen for, but here they were seronegative and transmission did occur. One West Nile virus donor that resulted in three recipients getting West Nile virus disease. Two lung transplants had either influenza or parainfluenza that was transmitted. So you can see that most of these, you know, unexpected, some of these events, because serology or NAC may have missed it, and so on. There were 42 donors where there was a report generated for a fungus or a parasite, mostly fungi. Candida and Aspergillus resulted in transmission. There was one death in the patient who had Aspergillus infection, so this is something I believe we may not identify immediately. There can often be a delay in diagnosis, whereas candidemia we detect quickly. And the parasitic infection, they did not identify, so I cannot give you any details what was that transmitted. But it was either Trypanosoma cruzia or strongyloides. So having said all this, what those previous slides emphasize again is the proven risk of transmission is fairly low, and the risk of death is 0.03 for a transmitted infection, suggesting that most organs, you know, could be transplanted, provided there are clearly some contraindications to them. So all organ donors, typically they will collect, the OPTN will collect blood and urine cultures. We talked about screening for HIV, Hep C, and Hep B. You will get syphilis testing done. Epstein-Barr virus is not routinely done, but it's recommended as one of the screening. All toxo donors, if they are heart donors, will get tested, because toxoplasma, as many of you all know, the oocysts insist in the muscle, including the muscle of the heart. So when that comes to you and you immune suppress the patient, they develop myocarditis and die. Sputum cultures are done routinely just for lung transplant recipients. On the other side, risk-based, this could be risk of endemic fungi if you live there. For living donors, latent TB screening is recommended. And if you do identify it, you should screen the donor to make sure the donor does not have active tuberculosis, which is a contraindication to transplantation. Now, we talked a lot about donors, but recipients need screening too, and I won't belabor the point. The reason we do all of this is to identify their risk, particularly for things such as CMV, EBV, and so on, but more importantly, to know when reactivation of these infections happen, that we don't blame it all on the donor. We also kind of look at the recipient status for some of these things. So I'm going to spend the rest of the lecture just talking about a few selected pathogens and conditions. By far, the most common calls that I get, or Ramesh gets, or y'all get, relates to bacteremia in the donor. So these two pathogens have been reported to cause the most adverse outcomes, both Staphylococcus MSSA or MRSA, as well as Pseudomonas. Now, as a general guideline, bacteremic donors can be used, provided the bacteremia is cleared prior to organ procurement, they have received appropriate antimicrobial therapy, and they are clinically improved. Now, the case that I showed of Mercer, he died, but still, it was abacteremic for 4 days prior to organ procurement. On our end, once we accept that organ, it's important to continue treatment, because that organ is now in your recipient, and you would treat them as you would have treated the donor. So for most bacteremias, a minimum of 2 weeks of therapy. And if it's Staph aureus and Pseudomonas, even though there's not much of data, the guidelines recommend at least 4 weeks of treatment, because it may depend on the organ. Kidneys are small, not very vascular. Livers are large, full of blood, full of potential microabscesses, so you might have to base your risk assessment based on that. If you have non-bacteremic localized infections, and this frequently comes up in urine cultures in a kidney transplant recipient, we don't know the risk, but we do know that there is a potential for graft pyelonephritis, as well as dehiscence of the vascular anastomosis, caused by Pseudomonas and other things. So these are things which should be individualized, but typically if you have a pathogen that you can treat and the donor doesn't have overt signs of infection but the culture is positive, you can still accept those donors as long as they are not bacteremic. Similarly, for lung transplants, we get information all the time. Most of our routine prophylaxis perioperatively takes care of most of these pathogens, unless they are very drug resistant, like Stenotrophomonas or something along those lines. Bacterial meningitis is not a contraindication to accepting the organs, provided you have a pathogen you can treat, and that the donor has received at least 24 hours of antibiotics. And there are some reports from Europe and Spain that has looked at some of this data, and it's shown that the outcomes were very good. Transmission of syphilis is extremely rare, even though we do all of the testing. And just one point I put the slide up here, is primarily to tell y'all that y'all will start seeing what we term as reverse testing. And I'll show that in the next slide. But if a recipient of a donor who is RPR positive, we typically would treat as a case of late latent syphilis with 3 doses of benzathine penicillin, like we would have treated the donor. The new syphilis algorithm we're all used to doing an RPR, which then gets confirmed through a treponemal test. That's very labor intensive. It's hard to do high volume testing. So most public health labs have started doing an automated reverse testing, where they will test first for the treponemal test. And the treponemal test tells you there was syphilis. And then they do the RPR testing to give you some titers and so on. In case the RPR is positive, that's a positive test. If the treponemal test is negative, it's negative. But if it comes down and the treponemal test is positive, but the RPR is negative, then they use a third test, which is the treponemal test, to break the tie, so to speak. But the reporting will be quite clear, and I believe it has started September 1st. Yeah. So it's now, these are the reports you all will see. If you all have any questions, just call one of us, and we'll be able to walk you all through that. Donor-transmitted TB occurs approximately in 4% worldwide. This is not a statistic from the United States. But it's important that living donors be screened, and active TB is actually a contraindication to donation. So screening of the living donors is typically done using, you know, either PPD or one of the IGRA tests, which is like QuantiFERON. And if the donor, living donor, tests positive, every effort should be made before the transplant to rule out active tuberculosis. This last line, you know, living donors who have latent TB, what would you do? Typically, you would consider them for latent TB treatment, but that should not be a contraindication to organ donation, that completion of treatment has to occur. It's best to call one of us, and maybe we can kind of individualize that case as necessary. What about West Nile? You know, West Nile is now endemic. As you can see in the map, all the green areas have reported West Nile disease as of September the 8th, as of September the 4th this year. So a few things we have learned. Transmission from donors to recipients of West Nile virus has occurred. But a few important things is that seropositivity in the donor does not predict risk of transmission. Now, if you have a donor where you did nucleic acid testing and detected the DNA, that increases the risk of transmission. But in many of these reports that occur transmission, the donor has actually been, you know, negative NAT. So they're still struggling with, should we really screen donors? And the guidance at this time is universal testing, as they do all blood products, will result in significant loss of organs, you know, given that this disease is quite endemic. So they don't recommend that. But what they do is, if you have unexplained encephalitis, which is serious West Nile virus disease, you should probably avoid using that donor. COXI, the guidelines are a bit more straightforward. What is shown is the area where you're likely to see a lot of coccidioidomycosis. And both transmission from donor to recipient, as well as reactivation of disease in the donor, in the recipient, can occur with immune suppression. So typically they would screen with serology, is what the guidelines say. And if it's positive, consider fluconazole is recommended as prophylaxis in these patients. Strongyloides is endemic in the world, and certain parts of Southeast United States is also endemic. So we will see strongyloides occasionally in patients in the United States. Typically, even though the recommendation is in endemic areas, screen everyone. There was a recent paper just from a few months ago that looked at this and said just 10% of all organ procurement organizations actually screen for strongyloides. So really, if you do screen and it's positive, you use ivermectin. Many centers in India and all just give the recipients one dose of ivermectin and they forget about doing all screening, which is pretty much takes care of that disease. Chagas disease is endemic in Central and South America, and it's recommended because of the adverse outcomes that people be screened from these regions, both recipient and donors. The risk is highest for heart transplants, so a heart transplantation from a positive donor is not recommended. What about liver, kidneys? They have been safely transplanted. If you do have someone positive, you can treat them with benzimidazole. You know, so there is treatment available for Chagas disease, so that should not be a strong, you know, never do it sort of. This is one thing, a recent report came from Colombia, of a transmission from donor to recipients that they proved using serology in the donor and serology as well as PCR testing of the recipients. These were four cases, two kidneys, one heart, and one liver. And the one donor had very mild symptoms. The second donor was completely asymptomatic. So actually, it's hard to imagine screening everyone. But the important thing is the recipients manifested with pretty much the traditional signs and symptoms of dengue that involved fever, jaundice, thrombocytopenia. The onset was very quick, between 1 week following receipt of the organ, and they all did well with supportive care. This is pretty much the only report I could come across of confirmed dengue transmission. And what's shown in the map are all the endemic areas shown in orange. Zika virus raised a lot of questions in the solid organ transplant community as it's transmitted through mosquitoes. It can affect donor and recipients. The risk of transmission right now is unknown. But there are four cases reported of Zika infection in solid organ transplant recipients that was not donor-derived. So it can happen, and all of those patients had very mild symptoms. They all did well despite. So at this time, donor screening is not recommended. We should focus more on advising recipients about travel to these areas, mosquito repellents, and so on. But it does not exclude disease donor organ procurement, and no routine Zika screening is required. I won't touch much on Ebola except to say there is only one area of activity right now in the Democratic Republic of Congo. There is actually an investigational vaccine, so that's great news, and that has really curtailed transmission very quickly. So typically, as with any Zika, we kind of look for travel in the areas 21 days prior to Ebola activity. Healthcare workers are at particular risk if they took care of these patients, or close family contact members, because they take care of the patient. It can be transmitted through body secretion. So I believe that was the last slide. So in summary, what we have shown here is that during the course of this lecture, that donor-derived infections can cause morbidity and mortality. But by appropriate screening strategies, we can minimize this risk significantly and increase the pool of organs that are available for potential transplantation. Now, screening tests, including NAT, has certain limitations, but they are certainly far better than serological testing. If we do identify donors at increased risk, we have a requirement to inform the recipients about that risk, what are the risk mitigation that we would do, and so on. And then finally, as clinicians, we should be aware that atypical presentations of infections, either unusual based on the risk factors, or unusual timing related to transplant, should always make you suspect donor-derived infections. And then prompt reporting to the safety officer of the program, and OPT, and is essential so that other centers can address preventive strategies or look for disease in the recipients from the same organ. So I'll stop here, and I just wanted to say thank you all, and I'll be happy to take questions.
Thank you, George. Does anyone have any questions?
Okay. Well, in that case, thank you all for your attention. And make sure you'll register for the symposium on November the 2nd. I think it's going to be a wonderful scientific session for everyone interested in transplantation. Thank you.